Hi, I'm Jean-Gilles Gadoury, and I'm the next guest on Rob's Inner Circle. Don't go anywhere, stay right where you are, and we'll be right back.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Rob's Inner Circle, broadcasting live on my personal Facebook page, on the Bobby Short Shorts YouTube channel, and on the Rob's Inner Circle Twitch account. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in to what is going to be an absolutely amazing and heartwarming story that we have for you tonight. It's going to be one of a kind, this show. Thank you so much, everybody. The usual shout out goes out to my good friend and producer of Rob's Inner Circle, Miss Jenny Duhame. And another shout out to our good friend and techie on the podcast, Patty Saragosa. Thank you to both of you ladies for being on and helping this show, your contribution. It's just amazing that you're on and the show is that much better because of you two. An honorable mention goes out to our good friend and supporter of Rob's Inner Circle, Mr. Vincent Gargano, who through his merch shop, 514 Branding Co. Montreal, provided this amazing t-shirt for us. Look at that. Isn't that beautiful? Wonderful. Thank you so much, Vincent Gargano, for your contribution to Rob's Inner Circle. And Vince is going to be launching officially his merch shop, and it's going to be going up on February the 24th on Wednesday on the occasion of his birthday. So Vincent Gargano, congratulations. And on behalf of myself, Jenny, and Patty, we wish you all the best. Much, much, much success. Thank you. We got some fantastic news because there were many of you asking what has happened to Daily Struggles. We haven't heard anything from you. You become quiet. What happened? Well, you found out last week what happened. We got the greatest news in the world. Daily Struggles has signed on with Rise Up TV on Roku. It's official. We're now on television, folks. And this is a thanks to all of our collective effort with all the wonderful people involved in the production, including both Jenny, who's producing the show, and also Patty, who's a techie on our show, and to the rest of the cast and crew. Mentioning any names would be unjust because I'm afraid I'm going to forget someone. But from all of us at Daily Struggles to you, thank you so much for all the amazing support that you've given us and that has allowed us to get the exposure that we needed to go on to a higher platform. There's lots and lots of work going on behind the scenes. We have lots of productions coming their way. Just be patient. Our official launch on Rise Up TV is going to be mid-March, and we'll be keeping you informed as the developments come along. We invite you to go onto the Bobby Short Shorts YouTube channel and to click onto the playlist so that you can see all of our previous Rob's Inner Circle podcasts, and as well, go check out our Daily Struggles. For those of you who are not familiar with it, we invite you to go on and give us some comments, some thumbs up, some sharing, a lot of liking. You want to subscribe to our channel and hit the notification bell, because that way you'll be the first to know every time there's something new coming up on the channel. Folks, it's that time once again. It's time to slip into our weekly ritual. It's time to let go, let the stress go down and relax and enjoy the moment just as we prepare, as we get into the mood to go on the show. So you want to breathe out a little bit, let down, let go of the stress, and we're going to be ready for the show. Ladies and gentlemen, it's that time once again. It's showtime. Let's get it on. It is time to bring on our amazing guest. He's a triple threat. He's a charming young man with a lot of talent and with an amazing story to tell. Ladies and gentlemen, help me welcome Jean-Gilles Gadoury.
I can't stop this feeling deep inside of me. Girl, you just don't realize what you do to me. When you hold me in your arms so tight and let me know everything's alright, I'm hooked on a feeling, da da da, I am believing that you're in love with me. Lips are sweet as candy, its taste is on my mind. Girl, you got me thirsty for another cup of wine. Got a buck from you, girl, I don't need no cure. I'll just stay a victim if I can for sure. All the good love when we're all alone, keep it up, girl, yeah, you turn me on. I'm hooked on a feeling.
Amazing, amazing, Jean-Gilles. Thank
There's
you
another
much.
French song, too.
There's another French song.
Yes,
yes sir. Go ahead.
It's Je l'aime à mourir from Francis Cabrel.
This is for our French audience. Ladies and gentlemen, mesdames et messieurs, voici Jean-Gilles Gadoury.
Moi je n'étais rien, mais voilà qu'aujourd'hui je suis le gardien du sommeil de ces nuits. Je l'aime à mourir. Vous pouvez détruire tout ce qui vous plaira. Elle n'a qu'à ouvrir l'espace de ses bras pour tout reconstruire, pour tout reconstruire. Je l'aime à mourir. Elle a commis les chiffres des horloges du quartier. Elle a fait de ma vie des cocottes en papier, des éclats de rire. Elle a bâti les ponts entre nous et le ciel, et nous les traverserons à chaque fois. Il veut pas dormir, ne veut pas dormir, je l'aime à mourir.
Amazing, very, very good, Jean-Gilles. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
You know what's exceptional, what makes this all that much more exciting is that, ladies and gentlemen, it's only 2 months that Jean-Gilles has been playing the guitar.
Yes.
Wow. And like I told you before we came on, I've been playing for 35 years. I'm not even as good as you are. You're an amazing talent.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate it.
Thank you for being with us, Jean-Gilles. You have an amazing story to tell us. But first, let's get to know you a little bit. So at the age of 2, you were going to some shows and your mother was showing you were your sisters doing some shows? And
yes.
Then at one point you said to your mother, hey, you know what? At 2 years old, you said, I'm going to be here next year.
Yes.
So explain to us what happened with that.
So my sister was in a choral. She was singing with other people. And I went to the show with my mother because I was going to see my sister. And it was something that interested me a lot. I liked a lot to sing, dance all the time. So I said to my mother, next year, I want to be in there with them to sing. So my mother talked to the girl in charge of this, and the next year I was in the choral singing with everyone, just like for three, four years old. And at 4 years old, my birthday, I did my first show ever for my birthday. I was singing with in front of people.
So the first form of arts that you were doing was singing, and that was followed by dancing right after.
Yes. So my sister was doing dancing too. So it's kind of the same concept. I saw her dancing, and everyone in my family was dancing. My mother was dancing. My grandmother was dancing. So it inspired me to dance, to try dancing. And I really liked it. So I continue dancing since today.
Okay, and you don't only sing in French and English. What's really amazing is that you sing also in Italian.
Yes, I learned Italian because I'm the spokesman for Ferrari Quebec.
Oh, that's right.
So yeah, so I learned two or three songs in Italian for them to sing for them. Yeah.
Okay, and which songs did you learn?
I learned Mamma son tanto felice and Volare. So yeah.
Okay, so you also play, you don't only play guitar, you also play the piano.
Yes, I play piano and I also play drums. So at my school, I'm in music and I play the drums. So yeah, I really like all kinds of instruments.
How did you play the piano? Did you play it piano?
I'm playing piano. Like I bought my new piano. I had a piano since I was like 4, 5. And I played it a little bit, but last year I bought the new piano and started playing more seriously. So yes, I'm playing piano, a little bit of songs, but since then I discovered the guitar. So right now I'm concentrating all my efforts into learning guitar because it's new. But yeah, I really like all the instruments, piano and guitar.
So your guitar is an Ibanez, and that's a pretty good brand for a guitar.
Yes.
That's a wise choice.
Yes, we bought it like 2 weeks ago. It's a new one.
Okay, so you knew you were coming out of the Rob's Inner Circle and you bought it for the show.
Yes, of course.
Fantastic. How many hours of practice do you do each day?
Maybe 3, 4, 5. It depends on what I have to do. If I have school, of course, it's a little bit less time. But I try to learn a lot every night, every evening. I go on the web, I search for songs I like. It's all songs I like, so I wanted to learn them so I can play and sing with my friends also. It's really fun to sing and play guitar with your friends, so we can sing all together and play at your rhythm. So yeah, it's really cool.
You know, Jean-Gilles, I hope you have that glass beside you somewhere, because we're going to have to raise and toast. And ladies and gentlemen, hang on a sec. This is actual grape juice, okay? So don't get the wrong idea. Jean-Gilles, to your health and success.
Thank
so
you
So happy
very
to
much.
Have you on the show. So
really
honored.
Really happy to be here.
And it's a pleasure for us to have you on. Salute. Jean-Gilles, tell us, of all of the instruments that you play, which one is your favorite?
Right now, I'd say it's guitar, because it's Lou. I just learned from it, so there's still a lot of things to learn and discover from that instrument. But I really like them all, because it's very different styles. You know, like drums, it's a beat, and it's really like rhythm. Guitar, it's you can accompany yourself and sings a lot of pop songs, even like rock songs you can play. So it's really different. And piano, it's soft. So when I like to relax, I go on my piano and I play relaxing songs. So it's really three different styles of music. So I like them all.
You're a very, very wise and smart young man. And I really enjoyed talking to you backstage when we were preparing the interview.
Yes.
And you're fully aware that living off performing arts might be difficult, because you know that we don't have any guarantees in this kind of business. So
yes.
From there, you are fully conscious that having an education is extremely important.
Yes, I'm fully aware of that. So I like a lot going to school, learning new things, in particular science, and even more particular the astronomy, all the space and all this stuff. But if the music doesn't work, because I'm aware that there's not that much people that can live about it, I'm going to go in these things, science and all of that.
Okay, your profound passion that you have for astronomy, there's an explanation for that.
Yes.
Because one of your big idols when it comes to singing and playing guitar is none other than Canadian astronaut Chris Hadfield.
Yes.
Okay. So,
it's a big idol. I think it's my idol. Yes.
Okay. You said that from outer space, he was playing a David Bowie song on his guitar and singing it.
Yes. It's a Space Oddity. So it's a really a beautiful song talking about space and all those all those things. So Chris Hadfield did it in space in the International Space Station. He played it and he sent it on YouTube with a video clip, and it's a really beautiful song and a really beautiful way to play it, interpret it.
You know, how long is it that you've been speaking English? Because I know that it's not very long, and you know what? I'm amazed because you speak very well.
Thank you. French is my first language, obviously, but I'm not bilingual, but I can speak English, you know, correct? Because when I went to the hospital, the first language of the hospital was English. So the doctors and all the nurses, all of this, they were talking English to us. So I had to learn English to understand what they say to me. So that's why my English developed a little bit more.
Okay, something tells me that one day, somehow, through all of this experience that you're getting playing guitar and from your studies, what have you, could it be that Jean-Gilles Gadoury, just like his idol, one day is going to be playing Major Tom in the space station coming to us live? Could that be? Is that something that you think that could possibly happen?
If the opportunities gets to me, I'll be 100%. It's a dream to do that. It's nearly impossible, but never say never. So maybe one day I'll be singing Chris Hadfield from space. It will be so much nice.
Okay, besides Chris Hadfield, which other singer, you know, who can you say is your favorite singer that has influenced you in some ways?
Since I was really young, my mother made me listen to Queen, the group with Freddie Mercury. So yeah, Queen does a lot of styles of songs. Sometimes it's soft, sometimes it's more rock, you can say. So it learned for me to like a lot of styles of music. So that's why right now I like to play every style, since from drum with a lot of beat and guitar or piano that is more soft. So yeah, that's a group that has inspired me a lot.
Talk to us a little bit about your acting career, because you're also an actor, you're a singer, you're a dancer, you're an actor. How about your acting career? Talk to us a little bit about that.
Yes, so I liked a lot to act from a small age too, but I did a lot of publicities and acting voice. How do you say that in English? It's voice.
Voiceover?
Voiceover. That's voiceovers for publicities and all of that in radio. I even did a publicity with PK Subban in radio.
Okay. Yes,
for the Montreal Children's Hospital Foundation. I did a voiceover on that for the publicity. I did a lot of things like that, an episode of a series from a real event that has happened in the real world, but reconstituted in scenes. So I did the role of a little boy that had cancer and his tongue was fluted. So he had to live with it and its consequences. So I had to act it, and it passed on the television in March, I think. March 2020, yeah.
Okay. Well, you know, before we get into your amazing story, because you have an amazing story to share with us, and it's really touching and heartwarming, you're a Queen fan, and I'm sure you relate to the song, We Are the Champions. That is your song. But before we're going to go to that, I just wanted to show our audience here a little clip that you did with your mom. Because you and your mom, it's like you're best friends. You have a beautiful relationship.
Yes.
So if I can get this thing to work. Okay, there we go. Okay. So ladies and gentlemen, this is our guest tonight. Our virtuoso triple threat, Jean-Gilles Gadoury. We're going to be showing a little clip of what he did with his mom.
Bye.
What an amazing performance. That's so beautiful.
Thank you very much.
You and your mom, you know, I see you two interacting and you truly are the best of friends and it shows. There's a lot of love.
That's funny because this was filmed like after I learned for only 2 weeks of guitar. And this was a guitar that I found in my home. It's a righty guitar. So I put lefty strings on it. So that's why it didn't sound like my new guitar. And now that I bought my new guitar, I can play really lots of song. But that's only when I learned for only like 2 weeks.
That's truly amazing. So you pulled your Jimi Hendrix there. Are you a Jimi Hendrix fan?
I know him, but I don't know much of his songs. But I know he's a great guitarist.
Okay, and, amazing.
Yes, I heard a lot about him.
Okay, so we were talking about you had, you know, at the age of 9, you know, just before the moment that something incredible happened to you on one particular evening, everything was going fine. And then within the wink of an eye, your life just changed dramatically. So you were telling me that everything was okay. You were in bed and you were going to the bathroom, whatever, during the night. And then something happened. Take it from there, Jean-Gilles, and tell us all about your story.
Yes. So I wasn't feeling really well that night. It's the 7th of September in 2014, I think. Yes, it's 2014. So, and I just like fall on the ground. I wasn't feeling real well at all. I had a lot of fever and all of this. So my mom took me right there, right at the moment. She took me to the hospital, and the hospital did a lot of tests. And after a lot of tests and the blood taking, they saw that it was a leukemia, a cancer in my blood. So they called a lot of hospitals, Saint Justine, Sherbrooke, and Montreal Children's Hospital, which is the one that I went to. And Montreal Children's Hospital was the only one who was able to take me, since my cancer was he has grown a little. He has very big growth since the beginning. He was a lot in my blood. So it was a questions of hours. If I wasn't treated, maybe I will die. So yeah.
So you're saying that the cancer had progressed rapidly.
Yes.
And off air, you were telling me that within 24 hours, if you were not going to be treated, the unthinkable would have happened.
Yes.
Okay.
It was a really short in time.
So you're there in the hospital, and then all of a sudden, in the snap of a finger, your life completely changed. I can imagine. From the moment that, you know, they had found that you had leukemia, all of the days and the weeks and months following, what was your life like? I mean, you know, in terms of how your life changed dramatically, as a 9-year-old, how were you dealing with this?
At first, I wasn't really aware in a sense, because when you're 9-year-old, you don't know really what is cancer, what is leukemia, all what it goes with, chemo and bone marrow, all of this, and the consequences of it, the risks. So you're not really aware of that. They don't talk about it very much. Sure, if it's another people in your family that has passed through this, maybe, but normally not. So that was something new to me, and I had to learn about it past the weeks. So at the beginning, I wasn't really aware, but since the weeks passed, I kept in conscience what that was and the risks of it. Maybe I will die. I wasn't sure. Even the doctors wasn't sure, because like I said, there was big risks. The cancer had grown really much. So I was about to die. So they had not a lot of time to save me, but they were able to. And I really thank them for that.
You know, that's truly an amazing story, Jean-Gilles. And wow, it's amazing, eh? That this is a lesson for everybody. We take life for granted sometimes, and you know, within the wink of an eye, things could just happen and change the course of our life. And by the way, Jean-Gilles, if at any moment you're having a hard time expressing yourself, you don't know the words in English, feel free to say it in French and I'll just translate it. Don't worry about it.
All right.
So you were going through all of these treatments. You're going through chemo and what have you. You were getting the best attention from the best doctors possible. You told me you spent 3 years at the Montreal Children's Hospital.
Yes, in total, I was in isolation for 3 years because even when I had breaks, I went home. I had to be isolated because my immunity system was low. So like the COVID, the persons, the risky persons, I had to be careful not to have visits and all of this. So even at home, I had to be isolated. And at the hospital, I wouldn't be able to see friends or go in the playroom and all of this. I had to stay in my room 24 hours.
And that's it. Occasionally, you were allowed to go see some family, then you had to like go back to the hospital right away. So your home for 3 years was a Montreal Children's Hospital.
Yes.
Okay. Then as time progressed and as the treatments were starting to take effect and all that, at which moment did you start seeing a significant improvement, some progress with your health? At which moment did you see that? Maybe 2 years in, 2.5 years in? At which moment?
At first, the first cycle of chemo, it didn't work. So we had to do other chemo, more chemo. But when the other chemo worked, they told to us the chemo worked, so you're going to be able to receive a bone marrow. So that's when we saw that I had chances to survive, and all was not lost. So that's when it gave us very much of hope. And after that, I had the bone marrow and I was in remission for almost 1 year. But after the cancer came back. So.
Oh, boy. Okay. So you went through a struggle of 3 years. Then you were okay. And you're saying after a year, the cancer came back. And the second time it came back, were the symptoms similar to what was going on the first time around?
The first time. I had bruises on me for not much reasons.
Okay.
I was not feeling really well. I didn't have that much energy. But the second time, because we were doing a lot of tests every week at the hospital to make sure everything was all right, we were able to see the cancer very fast. So it wasn't at a big state. So there wasn't that much symptoms, and we are lucky for that, because if we didn't take tests, maybe we wouldn't seen it, and it wouldn't have gone as great.
So they caught it quite rapidly, and and it spared you a lot of disappointment or whatever in the treatments and all that there. Your mother was absolutely amazing. She was your pillar. She was with you day after day. And both you and your mother just knew inside of your heart there that you knew that you were going to pull through with this. And there was no way that you, even for a second, were even thinking that this is not going to work. You knew all along inside your head that you were going to make this.
Yes, I think the moral has a very big part in this. So all the time that I was in the hospital, I was always sure that I was going to make it out of it, because the first time I didn't know what to expect. So I was just like, oh, okay, I'm gonna do treatments and then I'm gonna go out from the hospital and go back to a normal life. So I just did all the treatments and never stopped believing that I will get out. Had the hope for it, because before I went to the hospital, I was always with my friends at school, with my family, having great times. But when I was at the hospital, I lost those times with the family, the friends, and all of this, because they wasn't able to come see me. So, and I wasn't able to see them neither. So it's at the hospital that I took a fully consensus of la preciosité,
how precious?
Yeah, how precious were those moments?
Okay.
So when I was at the hospital, I was like, I have to fight because I want to go back to those moments. Had a great moment with my friends, laughing and all of this, playing games, see my family back, my cats, my sister, my brother, and all of this. So I fought it for them, and I was like, the faster I heal, the faster I'm going to be able to return to this. So that gave me hope.
You have the strength and determination of a lion. And you're so inspiring, Jean-Gilles.
Thank you.
Jean-Gilles, you're an ambassador. You're involved with so many fundraisers. You're involved with Ferrari. So tell us about all these foundations you're part of. You're with Walmart, Ferrari, you got the Montreal Children's Hospital. How many things are you involved in?
So I don't know if you want to share my screen, but I have a picture.
Yes, by all means, yes.
All right. So there is me with the president of the Charles-Bruneau Foundation, which is raising money for the research and all the to heal the sick kids and prevent this. So I'm going with almost all of their raising events, and I'm going there because they saved my life literally. So I'm doing my part to save other lives. And there, I saw for the first time Joe. Joe, what's son last name? Son nom de famille?
Ah, c'est Joe, le président.
Joe, the president of Ferrari Quebec.
Oh.
I saw him. I sing there, and he saw me, and he said, "Do you want to go in the Ferrari events with us to be your spokesman with Charles-Bruneau?" So I was going to their events to represent Charles-Bruneau, the foundation, because they raised a lot of money too for the foundation. They are raising like thousands of dollars for the foundation. So I was going in their event to help them raise the more money possible. And that's when they tell me, you can be our spokesman for Ferrari Quebec. That's how I became the spokesman for them. And Charles Renault, since they saved my life, I'm doing my part for them. Same thing for Fondation Opération Enfant Soleil. It's the same thing. They saved my life. They're raising millions of dollars for sick kids. So I'm doing my part. I go to the Téléthon all years to sing and raise the more money possible. I have other photos too. This is when I was with I was doing the publicity that I talk sooner for the Montreal Children's Hospital Foundation. We can see it there.
Okay.
To raise money, because in the month of December, 2 years ago, I think, every dollar that was gave to the foundation, PK Subban gave it double. So there was a publicity for this, and I was healed at the Montreal hospital, the children's hospital. So I did this too, another photo with them. That was when I did the DJ, because one of the things that kept the moral for me at the hospital was making other laugh and smile. So I had my DJ thing, and I was doing music and parties for the nurses and my mother all the night. I had a lot of fun. This was at the Téléthon Enfant Soleil. Chris Hadfield did a video for me, my idol. He did a video for me to say hi, and he was so grateful. And it was a magical moment for me. And that's when I sang at the Téléthon. I sang 4 or 5 years, and it's really great, yeah.
Okay, you have maybe one or two more pictures to share with us?
All right. That is the Walmart. Wow. They raised $3 million for Operation Enfant Soleil, and this year I was the Enfant Champion. It's the Children's Miracle Network. It's like a corporation that regroups all the foundations for sick kids in North America, And I was chosen, all the foundations choose a representative to go in Florida and talk to the big heads, the boss of the companies to motivate them to raise money. So I went there and I talked with all the people. There was Walmart, and I did a lot of things to help Walmart raise money. And this year they raised $3 million for Opération Enfant Soleil. So that's when I was on stage with them to give the amount of money.
Jean-Gilles, we'll show one more picture and then if we can get back to the interview.
All right. So thank you. This is when I raised money with Ferrari Québec for Charles-Bruneau. They did an event and they raised money with all the Ferraris. They were doing tours and all of this. So that was really cool.
Jean-Gilles, that's totally amazing.
Yeah.
And, you know, on behalf of everybody, of all the people you're helping, wow, it's just, for them. Thank you so much. Jean-Gilles, this is for you, my friend. Toast to you, my friend. Long life, success. There we go.
Thank you very much.
Such an honor to have you on our show tonight, Jean-Gilles.
It's an honor to be here.
We're getting some comments over here in the audience saying that you have inspired them. It's great. You know, it's just beautiful watching this. This is great. So, Jean-Gilles, these episodes with your health, they were life-changing. In which way have these episodes changed your life? You know, what's different about you now after you have gone through this?
It learned me to think a new way about the life. Like before, like I said sooner, and like we talk backstage, I saw life, I took all for granted, like everyone does that doesn't understand it. It's normal to be with your friends, to talk to everyone, healthy and all of this. But when you lose those things, you see the importance of them, the small things that make you happy in your life. So right now, compared to before, I learned to really to take those moments, those little moments that makes me happy, and appreciate them at the maximum in my life, because that's what makes us happy. So I'm really grateful for those little moments. Even it's a lot of little moments altogether, it forms a lot of happiness in me. And to see life one day at a time, and do all the dreams you can, because you never know what's going to happen the next day. So you do all the possible today, and you live a day at a time.
If we can live in a world according to Jean-Gilles Gadoury, what would the world be like?
I think I will try to help the most possible the children's health. Because the children are the future, they are the future literally, and no one would have to pass through this things. It's really not great. It's painful, and some people die from it. So I will try my best to invest a lot of money in research and equipments, so no people have to pass through what I passed.
Okay, and where do you see yourself in 5 years?
I like to be still invested in those charities and all of these things, because I'm going to be grateful for all my life. They saved me. So I think I'm always going to be all my life doing these type of things. I like to do also music and talk shows like this podcast and talk in front of people. I really like to, in French or in English. I really like to do these types of things, so I'd like to continue doing this if it's possible for the next years, maybe for the rest of my life. It's the chance if there's chances, and if not, like I said, maybe in science, in astronomy, maybe I'd have had to mash up these things, astronomy and music, and do like Chris Hadfield and sing in the space.
You know what? And I'm going to tell you something. I am absolutely persuaded that you will do very, very well.
Thank you very much. That encourages me.
Well, Jean-Gilles, you know, you're an exceptional young man. And like I said, you've been inspiring throughout your young life. And tonight you're touching home. You're touching the hearts of our viewers tonight. And it's just an amazing moment that I'm spending and the rest of a whole audience is spending with you tonight.
Thank you very much. It's really appreciated.
Jean-Gilles, we have a special guest that we want to bring along on the show with us. Is that person beside you right now?
Yes, of course.
So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Jean-Gilles' mom, Marie-Josée Gadoury.
Tu veux que je prenne tes oreilles?
Ouais.
Oh my God.
Good evening, Marie-Josée. Hello.
How are you?
Just fine. Wow, I'm really excited. We're having a great podcast tonight. Your son, congratulations. What an exceptional young man. And what a courageous young man. Wow, what a story.
Yes, I'm very proud he's in life. It's a gift from life to I can keep my baby. I was really, really scared. But now, like you say, every day it's a maximum we can make. And I kiss him all the time. You see in the video, I kiss him. I never stop kiss him because I never know if he's still there tomorrow. So I appreciate every time with him.
It's absolutely beautiful seeing the chemistry you have between you two. There's lots and lots of love, and it's very, very apparent. What a team. You two are just so beautiful together.
Oh, thank you. I want to thank you that in your show you invite kids because you give them chance. So Jean-Gilles, really appreciate that you invited.
Well, you know what? Here at Rob's Inner Circle, it's all about teamwork. We have an amazing producer, Jenny Duhame, who's really, really good with getting the guests on the show. So I'm not going to take the full credit. I got Jenny working with me. And behind the scenes also, we have Patty, who's doing the tech work. So this is all teamwork. Rob's Inner Circle is all about teamwork. And we are, like I said, so proud to have you with us.
Marie-Josée, you're grateful.
Marie-Josée, can you recount to us, can you share with us what it was like to go through such a very, very challenging, actually two challenging episodes in Jean-Gilles' young life?
Well, it's sure it's my most difficult thing it's happened in my life. I have three kids, and one day the doctor say to me, you're going to be here for a very long time. And I think so it's 1 week or 1 month, but she say to me, it's more than 6 months. So it's in one time I lose my two other kids stay at home because they can't come. And my boy every day, every parents, they say them, maybe it's 800 person, it stay alive. But Jean-Gilles, it's every day we know. So every day I was really scared to lose him. And we sleep in the same bed for 3 years in the hospital because I was scared that his last time his hand is hot in my hand. So, and if he have a bacteria come in his blood, he have 1 hour to have a blood transfusion because he dies. So I sleep all the time and all the day I touch his hand and I say, if it's come hot, I phoned the nurse and gave him an antibiotic. I don't want to lose my baby, you know? So for 3 years, I was really, really, really scared all the day. And I wish that to nobody because I stopped work for 3 years because I can work and say maybe today my boy gonna die, you know? I want to be there for him. And Jean-Gilles was very, very a clown in the hospital. So it's helped me very, very much because me, I know that like four kids in the same time with Jean-Gilles have that and they die at the hospital. So I know what is really, really danger. So I was all the time crying when I'm not with Jean-Gilles. So when I go back with Jean-Gilles, like I come back from the bathroom, he always sing and dance and make me laugh. So he give me very strong to keep smile and hope. And I love this clown. He said to me, it's a music save his life. So since his baby play music, and he play music at the hospital, and now he play music, so I can follow him everywhere in the world. I be there.
Wow, that's great. Wow. Hey, Marie-Josée, can you share with us, because you were telling me that the doctors were saying there were different steps to be taken in order for him to progress to another level. And then you just said flat out, he's going to make it here. He's going to make it there. He's going to make it. And exactly what you said, it just came like it happened.
Yes. Well, the day the doctor say, I have to speak to you. And there was two doctor. And they say to me, the chemo is not working. And just few weeks ago before, I see on Facebook that when the chemo is not working, you die, you know. So the little boy make party for Christmas, but two months before. So I think so, maybe my boy gonna die. So I don't want it. So I say, you need a bone marrow. What is the date? And she say to me, you don't understand. Before, we have to know if the chemo can go in his body, if it can't work. And after, if he can have a bone marrow. And after, if we find a bone marrow, I stop her. And I say, what is the date? And she say to me, okay, the date is 7 January. I say, okay. I go back in the room and I say to Jean-Gilles, this is what we're going to make. First chemo, 2 chemo, 3 chemo, 4 chemo, bone marrow. After, it's Hawaii and go back home with the cats and the family and party. And Jean-Gilles, it's a dream they give to him, Hawaii. I phone them and they say, yes, so Jean-Gilles going to have it. So I say to Jean-Gilles, when we go out of the hospital, we go Hawaii. And he start to rock and run. He want to go Hawaii. So I give him all what he love to do after. What he want to make, I say. One thing, I was very, very... Blondie, he said to me, I want to go to the Nintendo store. I say, yeah, no problem. When we go out of the hospital, we go to Nintendo store. So when we go home, he said to me, now we go Nintendo store. I say, okay, where is it? He say, New York. I say, what? Me, I'm going to drive to New York. Okay, I promise you. So we go to New York just for see the Nintendo store.
Did you drive to New York in a Ferrari?
Oh, at that time he was not speaking, but I'm sure the president is so nice with Jean-Gilles. He gave him all what he want to drive, and he's really nice with Jean-Gilles because the president lost 2 sisters for cancer. So he know it's really, really important to search for the research. So when he see Jean-Gilles sing, he say, would you like to sing for us? And we raise money for the kids. And Jean-Gilles, it's a dream for him that no kids have what he having, because it's not really nice to see your boy at 9 years old and lose his hair and lose his friend and lose it all. And the mother know that it's dangerous for his life. I don't want nobody have what I have through, and with Jean-Gilles and all the family, you know, all the family have a bad dream, you know. But now, last time we go to the doctor for 5 years, we go every 3 months. Okay. And every 3 months, the doctor say to me if it's he gonna die or if we have 3 more months with him. Okay. So it was scare every 3 months. I say maybe it's the last 3 months, maybe it's the last 3 months. But when we go in January, this 1 month ago, he say to us, we see you just in August 2022. So it's first time, it's just in 18 months. So me and Jean-Gilles was so excited for the first time. We have 1 year and a half. Don't think that maybe something happened. You know, it's very good that now is almost 5 years of remission. So thanks God.
And it shows that you have such, when I say a strong character, I mean this in the sense that there is nothing that is going to get you down. You were convinced, you know, like you were saying there, he's going to do this, he's going to do that, he's going to go to Hawaii, we're going there.
And, yeah.
And you just pulled through and it happened the way you want it to happen.
Yeah, I think so. When you're a mother, nobody can say to you, they're going to take your baby, you know? So I say to Jean-Gilles, let's go. We're going to make it. We stay together.
Marie-José, I don't know how to formulate the question, but how is it that a mom such as yourself could actually dig within deep inside herself and to gather this courage and it's like to put inside your mind that no, this is not going to happen. My son is going to make it. But it must be hard because you know fully well that it's the doctors weren't giving you encouraging news, right?
So no, it's really rare that kind of leukemia Jean-Gilles have stay in life two times it's come back and bone marrow. So I know it's a miracle, but I can say to you, yes, I'm a big, I don't want to lose my baby. So I'm very strong, but I can say to you too, that my father, he very, very think that Frère André, he can make miracle, you know, it's at Montreal, Orateur Saint-Joseph. Frère André, he makes miracle. He's the only one in the world comme Saint-André. So my father say to everyone, Saint-André gonna give a miracle for Jean-Gilles. And one day, the newspaper, the journal say, miracle, Jean-Gilles is alive. And he go out from the hospital. So my father buy all the journal and go in Bedford where we say, and he say, look, Frère André make miracle. You know, in my family, we like this, you know, all together we pray, and the energy too that we're in a Facebook time, you know, Facebook in 2014 is really there. And all the people every day say to Jean-Gilles, let's go, Jean-Gilles, I pray for you. Let's go, Jean-Gilles, you can do it. You know, we have a big, big, big family Facebook because since today, 5 years, they follow Jean-Gilles. And Jean-Gilles like to read what they say to him. So thanks for all them.
Well, he's got something like 12,000 followers, I believe, right?
Around it, yeah.
Wow. And he's also involved with the Twitch community as well, the gaming?
Yeah, but when he was a Children Miracle Network, Extra Life, he was a partner with him. And after they asked him for stay, because Jean-Gilles is really, really love gamer. So last Christmas, with his friend, he takes $22,000 for give a gift to the children sick. Because he can do what you like, play video, and the people look them because it's like very popular. The people like look the video, so they give money for their children. And Jean-Gilles say, please help us, because when the first cancer to Jean-Gilles come, there was a kind of chemo. But 1 year after, just 1 year after, they have a new chemo from USA. It's a Buffulcin. And it's come really, really hard in the body, but it's come very near to the bone marrow, very near. So the cancer have last chance to come. So because of the research, they save his life, you know. So I know that when Jean-Gilles make raising for the kids, it's very, very important. Every time he can save one life more, you know.
So he held a fundraiser on Twitch, and that raised $22,000.
Yeah, in 5 days, just playing video.
Amazing. Wow.
And when we go to USA, the people of Extra Life, it's like the last time Jean-Gilles, one time in a day, it's every in the world playing, and they raise $10 million.
Oh, wow.
In one day. And the gamers are really implicated for that. So Jean-Gilles, he want to go in every school in the Quebec, because sometimes in the school you can make volunteer. Yes. And that kind of volunteering you can make. You can play video for 12 hours and your 12-hour volunteer is make. Wow. But the time you put volunteer, you raise money, all your family help you. So every money, every dollar, we take it for save the kids, you know.
Wow, just amazing. And the first time he got his transplant, that came, you were saying, from a newborn baby from the umbilical cord? Is that where they got that?
Yeah, the first time they take this one. But okay, the second time, the baby umbilical, it's less chance you die. It's less chance. It's more soft. So they try it, but it's not work. So they go with the more hard one. It's really, really hard for the body, and a lot of people die with this. It's in French is par sang périphérique. I don't know in English. You have a transfusion for sang périphérique. So they go in with the fly, the airplane. They go take the blood of one people, and they give to Jean-Gilles, and he have in 1 month, he have everything you can have. You know, after these effets secondaires, I don't know in English.
The side effects.
Yeah, side effects. Jean-Gilles have it all. Like, he have cancer. The doctor came in my room and he say, Jean-Gilles have a lymphoma. And I say lymphoma because I can make in my head 3 times, you know. I say my heart gonna stop. And she say lymphoma. So I say, what you do? She say, we're gonna give him chemo. And for 30 seconds, I say, no, I can't take more. So if I die with my heart, it's now. So I count in my head and I stop, hear the doctor for 30 seconds. I say, now if my heart is not toughing that, I die. And after 30 seconds, I'm still there. So I say, okay, what we do? And she say, we're going to kill all the lymphocyte B. We're going to kill all. And that the lymphoma going out, and after that we gonna give him transfusion for 1 year of immunoglobulins, and it's work, you know. Every time let's go, what we make and we gonna do.
Well, you're amazing. You're an amazing mother. It's such an inspiration. It's just beautiful to see you two together. How there's that beautiful chemistry between you. And it was so fun having you on, Marie-Josée. Thank you so much. Is Jean-Gilles nearby?
Oh, just 1 minute. I think so. He go bathroom. Just one minute. Oh.
Jean-Gilles? Ladies and gentlemen, we've been talking with a triple threat tonight, Jean-Gilles Gadoury. And here he is. He's back. Yeah, Jean-Gilles. Jean-Gilles, we've come to the moment where we're going to have to sign off and say farewell. So we're going to give you the final word, Jean-Gilles. What's the advice that you can give someone out there who's not encouraged to pursue, it could be from anybody, to pursue what his dreams are? What is the advice that you can give to these people out there?
Never give up. Never give up, because sometimes they can be downs. Sometimes it won't work. Like, when I had the first chemo, it didn't work, but I didn't give up. And the second worked. So never give up, because you if you have dreams, if you have objective in life, there is always going to be downs and fails. But at the end, it's going to be worth it. So never give up, even if it's difficult.
Jean-Gilles, such a pleasure to have had you on our show. Thank you so much. Okay. Stay where you are. Okay, we're gonna come and get you after the show. Okay, we're gonna have our juice party. How about one last toast for our friend Jean-Gilles? To you, my friend.
Thank you very much.
Jean-Gilles, we're gonna come back for you. Ladies and gentlemen, there you have it. That was our guest tonight, Jean-Gilles Gadoury, a cancer survivor, twice cancer survivor, an absolutely amazing young man, captivating, and just what a beautiful show we had tonight. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in. Stay tuned next week. We're going to have a funny man, Freddie Rubino, a comedian from Brooklyn, New York. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, thank you. And as we sign off, God bless and have a great week. Ciao, everybody.